Hi, everyone. My name is Dara. This is Dear Hallmark. This is my space where I nerd and geek out over all things Hallmark Channel movies, TV shows, and stuff. And I'm not by myself today. As you can see, we have in the home of Dear Hallmark, we have not only an actor, but a restaurateur, a husband, a father. You've seen him maybe in Chesapeake Shores, maybe in Christmas in Evergreen, and a host of other Hallmark movies. Basically, what I'm saying is he's not new to this. He's true to this. Everyone, please welcome Antonio Caone. How are you, sir?
Well, thank you for having me here. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. So I want to get started with just a fun question. What's a song that you have on repeat right now?
Oh, great question. I actually have Take Me to Church on repeat by Hozier. I don't even know how to pronounce it. I've never looked it up. I don't know. It's funny. I was just saying this morning. Like, there's something about, I don't know if it's his voice or the song itself. Mm-hmm. It's not even content. Maybe it is that just like deeply resonates. And I get things stuck in my head. I get these like codas that just repeat and repeat and repeat in my head. And so that song was in my head, and I ended up making it my morning alarm. Cause I was like, just lean into it. If it's going to be there, let it be there.
Right. Yeah. For me, I'm digging, it's my sister's fault. She sent me Leslie Odom Jr.'s It's Beginning to Look a Lot Like Christmas. So I've just been having that on repeat because it's so jazzy, even though it's a Christmas song. His voice is just like velvet.
He can do anything. Look, if you had asked me a year ago the same question, you know, at the end of the year when Spotify is like, what were you listening to?
Yes.
Every single thing was Hamilton. Everything. Yeah. It was embarrassing. I had Hamilton podcast, you know what I mean? And so I would be walking around singing Guns and Ships all day. So listen.
Yes, Lafayette is that dude. Yes.
He was up in Vancouver shooting. And I had a friend who knew that I was like obsessed with everybody who was in that cast, and they're all, you know, we're going to look back in 20 years and be like, how are those people all in a show together? It doesn't make sense. Yes. But she would creep on him. He has like this giant poodle. She would creep on him and like take a photo and be like,
yeah. Oh my gosh. That's so cool. Literally my sister and I, like, we would just drive around in the woods just so we could listen to the Hamilton soundtrack, like in the car. Cause you know, the car speakers, there's something different.
Nothing like it. It's everywhere.
Man. Oh man. So let's talk about your background a little bit. For people who may not know, first of all, you guys need to visit his website. Whoever wrote that, did you write your bio on your website?
Yeah.
I really, like, the voice is so strong. I felt like you were talking to me through that.
Thank you.
So people can read that and see a little bit about your start in acting, but I would love to hear it from you. Because you started off with a sports dream and then you kind of found your way into drama through an injury. Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, my probably not featured on the website is that my first job actually in the industry was around 13. I was hosting a show. I was at my mom's school on a PA day, like a public development day or professional development day, because both my parents were teachers, and there were some guys with cameras. And I was the son of a teacher. So the school was like mine. You know what I mean? I wasn't in class. I'd wander around. And I was like, hey, can I help you guys get you coffee, whatever? And they were like, what are you, why? Like, they didn't know I was a teacher's kid. They just thought I was some truant little brat.
Right.
And so finally they were like, listen, we're doing this thing. We're looking for a host of a show. Do you want to audition? I was like, I don't know what an audition is. They're like, you just read this thing. It was about oranges, rescuing oranges from the ocean as a way to practice cleaning up oil spills. So I was like, sure, I don't know. I did it, thought nothing of it. It was like, deuces, bye. You guys don't want coffee, whatever. And then I got a phone call that I'd booked this job, and I hadn't told my parents that I auditioned because I was dumb. I didn't even know that I had auditioned for something. And so I had to tell my parents that I had auditioned for this thing, that I booked it, and that it was going to be this ongoing, I was hosting a kids' TV show that if you grew up in Canada, but even more specifically in Ontario, kind of like you know, I'm 40 now. So if you were 13 when I was 13, you would have watched me every single day. So that was the beginning of it. But my dad, when I finished it, I was a kid. I was like, maybe I want to act. And my dad was like, yeah, that's not happening. Not a chance. And I didn't know why at the time. I'll tell you in a second. But so I had no real relationship to acting or to the arts beyond that. Dad said no. Dad was like, you could play soccer. Like I'd been playing soccer since I was six. In his world,
okay,
that was a more viable life choice than the arts.
Interesting.
Yeah, which was weird, but I'll tell you in a second. And then, so you get to this bit on my website where it's true. I was in school and I wasn't invested in the arts. Also, the way the world mysteriously works, my dad used to be a teacher at the school, the high school that I attended. So all the teachers knew me. He wasn't there at the time. He had long been ill. And so he wasn't a part of the school, but they all knew him and they knew like the kids. Mm-hmm. And so I, like a pseudo jock, had like three classes in a semester that were all sports related. And I was at a tournament with the school, and I busted my ankle, and that was it. I couldn't walk. Mm-hmm. I couldn't play sports. I couldn't do any of the things. And the drama teacher, or excuse me, the guidance counselor who knew my dad, took me into her office, and she said, there's a rule in school where if you can't be a full-time student, you need to have a full-time job. And because you have these injuries, it makes you a part-time student. And since you don't have a full-time job, you can't stay in school. But she's like, I'm going to make this work. So she put me in grade 9, 10, and 11 drama all in one semester back to back. So literally, I'd wake up in the morning and go to drama class. And then the bell would ring and I'd stay in drama class with a bunch of new kids doing the next year, doing grade 10 and then do grade 11. So it that kind of like set a really reasonable course for me. And then that same year, one of the drama teachers was like, hey, fun fact, you should be in the school play. Why don't you come audition? And I did. And then, you know, fast forward even further at the end of the year, that same drama teacher was like, you're great in the play. You're doing really nice in the classes. What do you want to do with your life? I was like, nothing. I don't know. I'm going to take a year off and like just figure it out. And she said, why don't you apply for a drama school? And if you get in, you go. And if you don't, then you do you. So I said, okay. And I applied to one drama school and I went and did my stupid audition and I got it. And I went in and I was the guy who would, you know, be sitting in a circle and everyone's like, talk about your drama experiences. And I was like, I skipped grade 9 because we did Hamlet or Romeo and Juliet. I skipped grade 10 because we did Hamlet. I skipped grade 11. Like I just had never read any of the grades. I had never done any of it. So yeah, this pivotal injury opened up a conversation, you know, with the universe, but with more directly a teacher who shared a path with me. And then just to bring this full circle, I told you brevity's not my strong suit. I'm sorry. The very first big gig that I booked, I was backstage on opening night after we'd finished. And this older man was standing at the door and he goes, ah, your dad would be proud. Mm. And I was like, come again? Like, who are you?
Right, right.
And he said, you don't know me. I said, I used to work with your dad and your dad very well. And I was like, oh, okay. Well, nice to meet you, sir. And da, da, da. And there were a few other people that like created context. And it turns out that my dad growing up was an artist. He was an actor. He had come from Trinidad. He studied in New York City. He used to do poetry and like spoken word in Greenwich Village. Wow. He went to Montreal, started the first Black theater workshop. He came to Toronto, helped start Caravana. Like the dude was a mover and shaker. And he was embedded so thoroughly into the arts. And when his kids said, I want to be an actor, he was like, no, I want something easier or better or simpler or more straightforward for you. Because the world that he came from, you didn't make the whole pie. You didn't make acting the whole pie. You know what I mean? Yeah. It was a piece of the pie. You had to do something. And then you could have this other tiny thing. And I was going like, I'm just going to make the whole pie. And he was like, that's not what we do. That's not how this works. That's not what people like us who come from where we come from. You know, he's an immigrant story. He's like, that's not it. So anyways, that's the context that the rest of that's not, you know, part of that's on the website. The rest of it is not.
Yeah, that's an amazing story. And another blurb I took from your website, you say stories can save lives, enrich lives, inform lives, and give life. I believe that. And as a writer myself, that's something that I resonate with. And so I want to ask you, now that you're kind of in the industry telling these stories through film, how do you see yourself, or do you see yourself telling stories through another medium? Like, did it open up a lane for you to explore storytelling in another way?
Kind of, yeah. I mean, I would almost say like the inverse happened. Before I was blessed with the opportunity to get to do film and TV, I was doing theater. Mm-hmm. And back in Toronto, you know, there were a little group of us, the company still exists. We built two separate theater companies. The first one was called Surface Underground, which my dear friend Peter Pasek was the driving force behind, who's just about to open Hamlet at Stratford as the opening director. And I'm not going to get to see it, but from what I hear, it's going to be exceptional because he's an exceptional artist. Mm-hmm. And so he and I and three other fellows started this small theater company. And so we were telling stories that were other people's stories, but we were telling it in a way that mattered to us. And we were very dialed into what we needed to hear and what we felt our peers needed to hear and what story we wanted to put on stage. And then further to that, myself, my wife now at the time, not my wife, and two peers started a company called Project Humanity. And through that, we were doing work in the community. You know, I have a very clear kind of like activist side. And so we're doing a lot of work in the community, and we were pulling stories and helping to recreate those stories so that we could reflect their stories through a lens that a wider audience could see. Mm-hmm. So that type of storytelling, you know, that's always been in me, like from young. I've been a writer. I don't even say that I'm a writer the way you're a writer. Like you're a writer.
Oh my gosh!
Hey, it's here. Don't I told you, you know, 2027 I'll finish it because I'm slow, but it's here. But you know, like I've never pushed anything to be published because it hasn't really been my lane. But that doesn't change the practice of it.
Sure.
And quite frankly, moving to Vancouver and starting to do Hallmark, I didn't actually understand what Hallmark was. Mm. And so at first glance, if I'm being very, very honest, I was like, why? What is this? Like, why does this exist? Is it good? Is it not good? Am I doing, like, I just couldn't place it. Mm-hmm. And it took a while. It took meeting people and listening to people speak about it to understand that even something that I don't have a relationship to has the same power of storytelling and the power to save lives and the power to enrich lives, even if it's not the story that, you know, it's not The Wire.
Sure, you know what right. I mean?
Like we have this thing in our head where we're like, well, this means something and this doesn't. It's like that. Well, that's not true,
right?
Because the medium is for the audience. So the audience that is changed are the one that can talk to you about the transformation. What did that audience member need? Did mm-hmm. that show up in the film? Yes. You know, like I'm not close to the dude at all, but I read a blurb the other day, that Tyler Hines wrote about the Always Amore that just came up, and he was like, yeah. One, he's like, it's a love letter to the restaurant industry, and yeah. Two, he there was something about loss, and he was like this pivotal scene was informed by my conversation with my best friend, and the two of them had just experienced the loss, I think, of that friend's mother. And like just the ability for an artist to draw these two parallels and to put them in the medium, even if the medium didn't mean to do that thing, it is yeah. going to do it by virtue of him having that integrity and the people on the other end needing something to be filled. You know, like it's going to coalesce and come together that way. And so you know, like I stand by those statements, and certainly as somebody who is a creator, I don't think that I used to think that you had to be at the center creating in order to be the one affecting change, and I just don't think that's true.
Yeah,
I think that our integrity, our life experiences, our point of view shows up for better or worse.
Yeah,
it'll show up on screen, and certainly, you know, like I used to feel this on stage. My Andrew Kushner, who ran Project Humanity with me and my wife and our good friend Dan Chapman Smith, he would always say that theater is the one place where true transformation happens. It's the one art form where true transformation happens, because it requires the audience to receive the information and send it back to the stage, and the stage sends it to the audience, and back and forth and back and forth. And mm-hmm. you can see the same thing 5 days in a row and have five transformations, mm-hmm. which, you know, like that is a thing that rattles in my head all the time.
Which is so true, because, and I'm not a theater buff, but I've been fortunate to go to the theater a couple of times, and as an audience member, witness that, like, when you are able to engage with an actor on stage and then them receive the energy that you're giving, even fuels them more for their performance, which is almost bringing it back to you. It's like a whole cycle. Like it's
alive.
Yeah.
I have goosebumps just talking about it. You can feel it.
Yeah.
Right. It inhabits the space. Those spaces are alive. Yes. And you know, the space on set is alive and the space in your living room is alive, but there's not a portal between the two that's inherently opened by you watching it. But when you're on stage and they're in the audience, you know, like, you're all in this dimension together.
Yes. So press into that Hallmark bit a little bit more. How exactly did you find yourself getting into the Hallmark space? How did that happen?
I mean, I got in the way, kind of anything else would happen. It's just sort of by auditions and a door opened up. I didn't target it. It wasn't, like I said, I didn't even know that it existed. I'd never heard of it before. But I will say that once I entered the world, the first thing I did, by the way, was with Andrew Walker, which was really cool. I ended up being on set with Andrew Walker, Marcus Rosner, and Taylor Cole. And like, you can't ask for a better group of humans. And I've talked about this before, but like, the spirit of those three people is so evident. They are just like kindness incarnate. They all have a point of view. They all have things that are interested in, blah, 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 blah. But at the root of them, they're just good humans humaning. And yeah. and so that was like a really interesting way to meet this network or this genre. Because it was just like so wholesome.
Yeah.
And I don't say that in a bad way. You know what I mean? Like, like I said, it was like good humans humaning. And so anyways, I just kind of found my way in, and I've certainly had, you know, versions of not ups and downs, but like moments where I'm like, what am I doing? Mm-hmm. Am I advancing in this? Is this where I belong?
Yeah.
And certainly like, and again, I've talked about this very publicly, but like, it's hard to be part of something that you may not see or feel yourself reflected in. And so like, how do you stand up and hold the world accountable for what we all have to pass on to the next generation? Mm-hmm. And like, we're not all going to get it right, and it's not going to be perfect, but it can't be imperfect for lack of trying. And that is always on my mind with everything I do, but certainly with the Hallmark world. So anyways, yeah, I got in with the same way you would anything else. I auditioned and like got lucky. And since then I've gotten to see the space that I can take up grow, which has been, that's been really exciting to see.
Yes. Yes, indeed. So talk about this new project that you are a part of. Curious Caterer Dying for Chocolate. Is this your first mystery that you're a part of?
It's the second, technically. So I did Darrow and Darrow.
Okay.
With Kimberly Williams Paisley and Wendy Malick and Barclay Hope and Lila Fitzgerald and the whole gang. That wasn't a mystery. Yeah, I mean, it was on the Mystery Channel. It wasn't a mystery in the same way, I think. Yeah, no, it was. It was. Yeah. So this is like my second kind of like foray into the Hallmark mystery world.
Mm-hmm.
It's very exciting. And again, you know, like, you walk onto set and you meet these teams. I was, first of all, jazzed that I was reunited with Andrew.
Sure.
You know, and like we're not BFFs, unfortunately. He's got on BFFs. But no, but he's like salt of the earth dude. And quite frankly, like, he was probably the first person when we first met. He was running, which is now Little West Clover. And I had the restaurants and we would talk about that. And like, anytime he's in town, he's always at the restaurants. He just shows up. He doesn't even like, I'm always like, hey, anytime you want to hit me up, and he doesn't say anything. He just books in and goes, and he likes good food and he likes, you know, like, so good human. But getting to be on set with everybody who was in this cast, I mean, between him, Nikki, and Aaron, I was like, I'm just in love. Like, I think they're amazing. You know what I mean? Like, they're there's so much depth to each of them. And certainly Nikki, like what she brings to her practice, I don't research people because I like to meet them authentically in real life. And yeah. So, but as a result of it, means I know nothing about them. And certainly when I speak about them, I understand that comes across sometimes as like a little ignorant. Like I'm like, I couldn't tell you if she's done one movie or 5,000 movies. Like I have no concept of like what her life was, which means I get to meet her like a real person because we're real people. But yeah. Her understanding of the craft, her practice, her ability to show up for people, her ability to just show up in the world centered, grounded with integrity is like, it's pretty unrivaled. Like there's something magical about her presence. And so I was grateful to just get to like sit across from her one-on-one mm-hmm. and be like, we're in a scene together and we just get to be here. That's beautiful. Anyways, the show itself is very fun. I don't even know what I'm allowed to say and not say, but it's a mystery.
It's a mystery. It involves chocolate.
yeah, it involves chocolate. I'll tell you a funny, not, this has nothing to do with the Curious Caterer, but while I was shooting Curious Caterer, I was also shooting something for Disney. Oh. And it just so happens that the scene that I was shooting the day before the first day of Dying for Chocolate, the scene didn't get finished. So the director came over and he said, listen, like, I know you're starting this other project tomorrow. Can you find out if you can come in? We'll just do a pickup shot. We'll get this one thing out of you and then we'll carry you on. I was like, no problem. It was a night shoot. It worked out, blah, 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 blah. Okay, cool. So I get to the Disney set and he was like, this is the one where the vat of chocolate falls over and drenches you. So you're going to be drenched in this chocolate. It's like drip, it's in your ears and it's all this stuff and da, da, da. Are you cool with doing that? I was like, yeah, that's fine. And then he stopped and he was like, I didn't even ask you. Like, he's like, I'm so sorry. I've been so busy. What are you working on? And I said, yeah, you can't make this up. I'm on a movie called Dying for Chocolate right after this. Yeah. And he's just like, it's just a picture. I'm like covered in this stuff. And I'm like, Dying for Chocolate.
Yeah.
It was a pretty nice moment of like the universe is going like, hey, this is cute. But yeah, this is one of the, I know that this, like the Curious Caterer is a series. So there's another one after this. I bet you they're going to do that one because you have Andrew and Nikki. And why would you not? It's a no brainer. Give them, let them do 15 things together. It's going to be 15 hits.
So talk about like what the energy was like on set. Cause even just hearing you talk about it, I felt like it sounds like you guys had a ball. Like you guys got on so well. I remember you jumped on a live with me one time and when we talked about chemistry and even not just in a romantic sense, but even in like a familial sense, like developing chemistry as friends amongst the cast. Can you talk about what it felt like to be on set with them?
Yeah. This set was, there was a lot of chemistry on this set and there were a lot of interesting people. I think a lot of them knew each other prior. Mm-hmm. I didn't. I knew Andrew. And then beyond that, I didn't know anybody, which again, I kind of love because you just get to find people authentically. I will say, I'm saying this because it's popping in my head and I want to honor it. Also because it matters to me. This was the first set that I was on for Hallmark that had a Black director. That was huge for me. That was huge for me.
Yeah.
I have been on, anyways, that was huge for me. I just want to say that.
Yeah.
I was excited by that just in terms of like what it meant beyond the person. He's fantastic. He is interesting. But I also just like, I appreciated being able to step back and to say like, what a beautiful first, you know? And I always come at it from two sides. I'm like, it's 2022. So to say this is the first really bugs me, but also the first has to be the first at some point. There's always the first of something. So like, I was very grateful that I got to be a part of it.
What's his name?
And Tony Mechie.
Tony Mechie.
Yeah, he's been a director of photography, for Hallmark for a long time. Mm. And so it's a very reasonable, you know, like next step ascension. Anyways, being on set, I mean, what I liked is there were a number of parents on set because I'm in my dad years.
Yeah. And
talking about your kids is like primo currency, but also I got nothing else going on.
Right.
and when we talk about chemistry, I mean, you don't know each other And so you got to find commonalities, right? You want to find each other. You want to find like what the spirit of the other person is, and how that's going to come about and intermingle with yours, so that we can start to go like, you develop a shorthand, whether it's through conflict or through camaraderie, whatever it is, there's something there that you know, like the ball gets thrown up in the air, and you both kind of keep it up in the air. And so the number of different personalities that were on this set, who all kind of brought different life points of view to the movie. Like one of them has a son who's a two of them have sons who are crazy famous actors, which I just thought, okay, I'll tell you the truth. They're having a conversation about their kids, and I don't know them. I don't know them. I don't know their kids. I don't know their lives. I don't know nothing about them. So typically, you know, mind your beeswax. And I am a person who typically does, but we were in a room together and I was listening, and they were talking about kids and their relationship to the industry, and whether like pushing them towards it is good or, and I was like, hey, food for thought, you know, like I was that when I was that age. So
yeah,
here's what happened with me, and here's what I would have preferred, and da, 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 da. And then we're just making friends, and they were super kind. We have a nice conversation. Anyways, fast forward like 2 days later. And then I was like, your kids who? Oh, I'm gonna shut my mouth, because we are not the same. We're talking apples and airplanes. We're talking apples and Learjets. Okay. Anyways.
Oh man. So,
a tidbit of honesty, but yeah. So there were a number. There was a lot of like talking about kids and families on that set. Yeah. There were a lot of talking about values on that set. Even if we weren't talking about values in like a holistic, like see my heart kind of way, but right. You know, it comes up in conversation as we're talking about the housing crisis and money and retirement, and you know, like, oh, your kid is 1 in 4, mine's 16 and 18, and like you really get a sense of like who each other are, and then that shows up in your scene in these tiny kind of remarkable ways, even if the scene's not about that. Like, like in the movie, Nikki has a daughter, and there's a moment, there's a thing that happens. There's a moment where the three of us, me, her, and her daughter are, let's say, in community together. I want people to watch this and be like,
yes,
I don't have any spoilers, but where we're in community together, and we each have a reaction to something that the daughter says. And we have the public and private. We have the reaction in front of the daughter, and then we have the reaction after the daughter leaves. And I remember we did probably like 4 takes of this, she and I. And I was just like, what a thing for the two. She and I had already spoken about our children with each other and the different things that we've gone through. And to be able to have this micro moment that we shared on camera together, to me, I was like, what a gift. You want to talk chemistry? What a gift that in that moment, something got sent back between us so quickly that grounded us and opened up this moment in the scene that, like, when people watch it, no one's going to think twice about it, but I know.
You know what I mean? That's so awesome. I love hearing about these experiences, especially as a viewer and beforehand, because then it changes my perspective with how I watch and how I take in the movie. So thank you for sharing that. I appreciate that.
You're welcome.
So you mentioned earlier, you did it kind of in a nonchalant way, but your restaurants, I definitely want to get into that, because, you know, we talked about storytelling, theater, acting, but you're also a restaurateur. So how did that come about? All while you're pursuing film.
Lucky. I mean, to be honest, like a lot of what happens in my life is like the light turns green and the car goes forward. And if the light's red, then I go left. When I moved to Vancouver, I didn't really know anybody. I didn't know how long I was going to be here. I didn't want to be here. I just thought like, this is gonna be a quick stop and I'll head back to Toronto. And when I got here, I met up with a couple of friends who I'd worked with for years in Toronto at 2 different spots, husband and wife team. And I just like hit him up. I was like, hey, I'm in town. I think you guys moved out here. Like, what's what? What are you guys doing? You want to like grab a coffee? blah, 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 blah. And he was like, yeah, let's meet up for let's just like go for a walk. And I was like, okay. I was like, that's a very Vancouver view, but sure. I was like, I don't like walking. Anyways, and so he picks me up in his truck and he's got his dog and we go out like for this long, like the type of walk in the woods where like, if you're from where I'm from, you think someone's going to like end you. And I was like, we're nowhere. Yeah. Anyways, but that's what was happening. And as we were walking, he was like, listen, I just bought a restaurant. And he's like, you know, I've got my team together He's like, do you want to come work? You want to be a part of this? And I was like, sure. And he wasn't offering like a seat at the table. He was just like, you need a job. I need somebody that does what you do. Like I've always been a person that is on teams that open restaurants and I quite like it. I love systems. I love organization. I love the operation. And I also think differently about restaurants than a lot of people do because I think in narrative, right? I think in storytelling. I think that a restaurant is an opportunity to tell a story that somebody needs told, whether that's about food, whether that's about their day, whatever that is, you know, like there's this restaurant chain in Toronto, like slightly, it used to be very high end called Oliver and Bonaccini, two guys. And my mentor, for lack of a more pretentious word, worked for them. And one of the things he would say to me is that like, when people come for dinner, they're hungrier for attention than anything else. Right? They're not showing up for a meal. They're showing up to be seen. They're showing up to be heard. They're showing up to be placed in the world. And that's kind of what we're transacting. And along the way, we can wine them and dine them and regale them and whatever. So anyway, so when my friend offered me this spot at the restaurant, I was like, game on, let's do this. It, you know, it was a landing spot. I had something to do now because the place wasn't built. So we'd have to go and like demo and I would just show up and be like, give me a sledgehammer, let's do this. And we'd build and et cetera, et cetera. And kind of at the end of the first year, maybe we sat down. He was like, right, we screwed up. Like you should be a partner in this. And I said, well, if a seat at the table opens up, I'm in. And if not, I'm not going anywhere. Like I'm just here until I'm not. And then over time, that's what we did. We just sort of like, I just kind of bought my way into the company. It's a small, it's me, him, a head chef, and then someone else behind the scenes who does nothing. And along the way, then it became like, okay, can I open a second one? Great, let's do this. Okay, can I open a third one? Game on, let's go.
Wow. So, and is each restaurant like its own separate thing, like its own experience?
Yeah, they don't speak the same language. They speak the same language of hospitality. Mm-hmm. But that like, if you went to one and went to another and you weren't told, you wouldn't know that we're related. Right. You know, like anytime I say to people like, oh, you know, I'm a part of this restaurant and like I work at this place, they're like, oh, are those the same people? Like it happens all the time. Mm-hmm. So there's the McKenzie Room, which is the first one. That's the oldest one. And we call it like rustic meets refined, which is, you know, just a nice tagline. It's like a cabin in the middle of Central Park.
Oh, you know, like I like
that. Like you're like, it's bustling outside and it's busy and it's grungy and it's dirty. And then you come inside and it's like cozy and warm and you know that you're in a city, but you can easily be transported and forget that you are. What hits the plate is influenced by what is happening around the world trend-wise globally. It's influenced by the classics, but it doesn't really have a linear way to be explained because Chef Sean Reeve, who is like a maestro, it's the stuff of creation. Like he really sits down and he mind maps out his plate and he comes up with something very unique and interesting and exciting. And like, I'll tell you this, and anybody who is like big in food knows that this is a wild thing I'm about to say, but for the first 5 years, he had a new plate on the menu every single week. Every single week, one brand new dish. And I can count on one hand the number of times he put something out that we went like, nah, it's not that good. Like these were, he was like swinging for the fences and hitting home runs every single time. It got to a point where it was like comical. So chefs around the city would be dining at our restaurant once every 3 weeks, and then like 5 weeks later we'd see a dish that we made on their menu, and not because they were stealing it, it's not that, it was just influential, right?
And
as we got to meet them, they would always say the same thing. They were like, you guys have this thing on your hands that doesn't play by conventional rules, and so you can really dream and you can really imagine and you can push the envelope without really, you don't have anyone to answer to, you don't have to ask permission, you're just doing stuff.
Yeah.
And it's nice to hear because it was always our point of view. We were like, problems need to be solved in real time. we don't want to go up to corporate. We don't want to get five green lights. We don't want all the key holders to be like, turn it at the same time. It's like, I see a thing. I understand what the problem is. I understand what the opportunity is. This is the strategy that's going to fix it. Implement it. Done. It's gone tomorrow. You get better, right? It's a growth mindset. Yeah. So anyways, the McKinsey Room plays by one set of rules. Then we have Say Mercy, which is Italian through the lens of American barbecue. So we've taken sort of the refinement of Italian.
Italian and,
yeah. Italian and the Southern US have a lot of things in common in terms of migration, how grains ended up there. You have rices and grains, all the heirloom stuff that came with the slave trade and ended up there. You have a rice called Carolina Gold, which literally landed in Carolina and traded at the value of gold at some point and thus got its name. But you have the same thing from the Moors, if you're looking at it in Italy. So as like sort of like all the surrounding countries, Spain and whatnot, would move in and out of Italy, they were dropping things off. You have major trade routes. So everything's fusion, right? Things have been displaced. Things come from one continent to the other, and then it becomes a staple. You have tomatoes. Anyone from Italy is like, tomatoes are ours. And it's like, no, they came from the Spanish, and they showed up with a queen who married into a, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
How it got there has a story. And the other thing with the American South and with Italy is that it's the food of peasantry, as most great food is, right? It's like the people who were the poorest had the littlest to work with, had the greatest imaginations, and they needed to feed their people, whether their people were their small family or their people was an army, whatever it was, you had to figure out how to stretch it, right? Like, even if we look at the United States, like towards the end of the slave trade, you have these enslaved people who have created ways of cooking and ways of stretching food out because they had to, and it went on to actually define the culinary culture at the time. So we kind of take these two ideas and we go, okay, well, they're similar. You have cornmeal on one side, you have polenta on the other. It's the same dish.
Yeah, right?
Like grits and polenta, there's no difference. And you also have coastline, so you get certain types of fish. Well, like, turns out that hamachi exists on both sides, or yellowtail, or whatever it is. So you're taking these two ideas, and then you say, okay, well, Italy rose to prominence, so now it's elevated, it's refined, it's very like, oh, it's Italian. And the United States South went the opposite. They're like, this is like the grimiest, most low-end whatever.
Yeah.
And so it's like, well, what if you take Hungry Man Dinner and shine it through like an Italian Michelin lens? Like, what do you get? And so that's the thought process. We take like the Coca-Cola flavoring from America, and we take the like classic ragu from Italy, and we're like, well, talk to each other. Let's see what you turn into. So
that's
the crux of that restaurant. It's very neat. It's like, you know, we're nerds. And then the third place is French. And it's just like, we call it French-ish because we are not French, but it is French. And we also just want to play by our own rules. So if someone says like, this isn't French, I go like, yeah, who cares? Like, neither am I. But yeah,
so cool. Yeah. Man, you've been such a delight. Thank you so much for stopping by the home of Dear Hallmark. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Before I let you go completely, is there anything else you want to leave the listeners or the watchers with, whether it's a word of encouragement, inspiration, curious caterer? You can literally just talk about whatever you want. It's your moment to have.
Me and a microphone are a dangerous thing. Like I said, like we were messaging earlier, I said brevity is not my strong suit. I will always talk. I have, for anybody who doesn't know me, I mentioned earlier, like I have this, like, again, for lack of like a better word, like an activist kind of streak or background or thing. Like I don't even give myself that title, because that title doesn't make sense to me. That's not actually what I mean to say. I just mean to say, I am a person who obsessively thinks about what we're passing on and what we're doing and why we're doing it. This has nothing to do with Hallmark or Curious Caterer or whatever, but it really has to do with like the whole world. And I just think, like, you know, for the past few years, if we look at Hallmark for the past few years, we've been talking about diversity. We've been talking about gender roles. We've been talking about parity. We've been talking about equity. You have like mahogany gets made, and it's like, okay, so does mahogany getting made mean that we're going like all white Hallmark again? Like, what is this? What do things mean?
Yeah.
And I will say, like, my driving force is like, we need to ascend as a people. And part of that, I think, means changing the way we read the script. And I don't mean that literally like the script that a network gives us. I mean the script that we all buy into. You know, like it's so easy to argue, to descend into politics, to descend into like I'm on this side and you're on that side, this partisanal way of thinking.
Right.
And I think that the challenge that I'm very interested in, and I will say, like, you know, this set, this is where Nikki and this is where Andrew and this is where Aaron and I like really connect, is like, what does it mean to challenge yourself to connect to your own humanity, to forget about being right, to forget about being wrong, but to actually start to say to yourself, like, is this what I want? Is this what I believe? Forget what I want. Not a practice of ego, but is this what I believe is going to nourish me and my people and you and your people? And is this going to create community? Because if we can get, you know, to a place where everybody is actively a part of our community, where you're actually on the inside of it with us, not the nonsense of like, I'm a follower of XYZ and I preach love, therefore I hate what you're doing. Like, how many times have you heard that? I just said it. It doesn't even make sense when you hear it. You're like, you literally just contradicted yourself. What's going on in there? You know what I mean? So I don't know. The thing that is rattling around inside me, I posted this quote on Instagram the other day because I read it. I'd never read it before from Desmond Tutu, was like, how do we get upstream? Like, how do we get out of the muck and go, okay, hang on a second. We keep standing in the muck and pulling up things that we don't want, but it's coming from somewhere. And we're complicit in it as long as we're standing here. And I'm not saying that because I know the answer. I don't. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying it because I'm going to run for office. I'm not. I'm saying it because we don't need to look for leadership outside of ourselves. We need to develop leadership within ourselves. Mm-hmm. We need to be the leaders. We need to lead the next generation because the people that we've entrusted with it have agendas. And I don't mean to say that like to sound like a conspiracy. I'm not saying like those guys are up to something. I'm saying right. Like we as people, we're all up to something.
Sure.
Because we need things, because we have egos, because we want things, right? Everything's transactional. That's just what it is. We're this is where we've gotten to. That's the script. We're just following the script. I'm not saying that that's a bad thing, but what I am saying is, and this is, I'll leave it here. But this is like what's in my heart is like, mm-hmm. How do we start to look at ourselves and look at our day to day and make these small changes, if we want to call them sacrifices, we can, but make these small changes that centers humanity as a way to develop community. It's what I'm invested in every day. And I get to, I'm so lucky that I have these two little kids because I get to practice it every single day with them. Mm-hmm. I get to practice it on them. I get to practice it through them. I get to listen to him talk about daycare and me sort of go like, huh, that sounds like a subset of something larger. I wonder if I can start to reverse this thinking in him because it hasn't coalesced into a scab or a scar inside of him. Mm-hmm. Right. Let's see if I can get him to lead with love. And then I watch him do it and I go like, oh snap, it works. Mm-hmm. And then I have to deal with my own scar tissue and go, how do I do that? Do I do that? I don't do that. Why don't I do that? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, and do it with gentleness and with generosity so that I'm still taking care of myself. I'm taking care of the people, you know, that are around. But when I talk, you know, when I write on my website, like stories can change lives. This is what I mean. And again, when we talk about restaurants, and when we talk about like the things that we do, I do one thing. I just do it through multiple platforms.
Yeah.
Right. Like I believe that a good meal can change a life. But it's not because of the food, although Sean's food will change your life. It's because that experience where two people can actually make contact is so rare that if we can find out how to codify it, if I can create a place where you know that every single day of the week you can come in and make contact with somebody and be seen and be felt and be heard and be filled up, you're not going to have to worry about what's growing in your backyard because you know that that's going to bear fruit or vegetables or whatever it is, and you're going to be able to fill somebody else up to help them with their backyard, and that is community. You know what I mean? So anyways, you asked me what's on my mind, that's what's on my mind.
Well, y'all, he's Antonio. I'm Dara. This is Dear Hallmark. I think you said already that needs to be said. I don't need to add anything to it. Thank you guys so much for tuning into this episode. All of my stuff, his information is going to be in the description box if you're watching on YouTube, or the show notes if you're listening via podcast. Thank you again, and I will talk to you guys in the next episode.